Well, I think we can bring this session to order. Thank you very much, friends. For the past 23 years, I have, in midsummer, been taking groups of young men to the Holy Mountain. Now, here the concept young bears no connection with chronology. I've had them from 18 to 88. Our purpose is to experience life in an Athonite monastery, and a significant part of this experience for these pilgrims is to engage in ecological activities, cleaning, gardening, chopping wood, kitchen duties, cleaning pathways, for a period of up to between 8 and 10 days, and all under a scorching North Aegean sun. In the year 2003, a quiet, introspective young Muscovite named Iriney Pikovskiy participated in the camp at Konstantinou Monastery. And here he is, now higher monk Iriney from the renowned Sretensky Monastery in Moscow. And he's about to talk to us on contemporary Athonite elders and their impact on Russian Orthodoxy today. In a number of ways, the Sretensky Monastery uniquely plays a role in organizing services, events, and travel that are very similar to what we, the Friends of Mount Athos, do as well. The purpose behind these activities is precisely to inform and exchange experiences about the Holy Mountain, to reveal its natural beauty, and, of course, to make known its spirituality. Sretensky Monastery also supports a number of cells on the Holy Mountain, both Russian and Greek. Moreover, it provides hospitality to Athonite monks who come to Moscow for medical reasons. Indeed, the monastery organizes the clinics where the fathers are to be treated. One more activity is Sretensky's press. Many publications consist not only of translations of modern Greek fathers into Russian, but also translations of sermons and speeches and talks of contemporary Greek hierarchs. Father Iriney is the bursar and an administrator of his monastery. In 2010, he graduated from the Biblical Studies Department of the Moscow Theological Seminary.
Academy.
As well as lecturing in New Testament theology, he has also written several articles on aspects of the Bible and on spiritual life. So, Father Iriney, we look forward very much to your presentation.
Thank you, Dimitri. So, my talk will be about the Athonite elders' impact over the Russian Orthodoxy in the 21st century. According to the Orthodox tradition, Mount Athos is a place where striking, astonishing, amazing monks live, whose prayer reaches heaven. There could be found answers to most intimate questions. The names of such elders as Paisios of Mount Athos, Joseph Hesychast, Siluan the Athonite are often cited in the Russian internet. Most contemporary pilgrims have never met them personally. How did they become so popular in today's Russia? What in their teaching touched so deeply the Russian soul? That is what I would like to talk about today. What does Mount Athos mean to contemporary pilgrims? A picturesque place for hiking, 20 ancient Byzantine fortresses inhabited by eccentric monks, a place where one can taste the Greek lukum and rakia to have some rest from family and work. If these things attract people to Mount Athos, this place wouldn't differ from other tourist sites at all. It would be just an exotic place for leisure. However, the reality is entirely different. Thousands of pilgrims come to the Holy Mountain not because they have a lot of free time or pockets full of money. In this holy place, they are eager to meet the living God and to find answers to their insoluble questions. And they hope that a miracle and the mysterious Athonite elders are able to help them somehow. An elder. Initially, this Greek word means an elderly person, an old man, geron. Now the Greeks use this word as a polite address to the chiefs of the monasteries, like abbots and abbesses, geronda, gerondisa. In Russia, the word elder has nothing to do with the church hierarchy. The elder means more than a respected priest or an elderly monk. First of all, the elder is a man of high level of the spiritual life. His life doesn't depend on his political state or on a state of political system or on the church authorities. He starts his life in a desert place, fasting and praying. After many years of a struggle against passions, God endues him with gifts of wisdom and prophecy. If people disclose such a hermit, he comes out for public ministry. He starts healing the sick, revealing mysteries of a future and consoling thousands of people with word of hope and encouragement. A classic example of such an elder is Saint Seraphim of Sarov. He was a hermit who had spent 1,000 days standing on a stone to be granted the gifts of the Holy Spirit. He was strict towards himself, but mild and friendly to others. He joyfully met all those who came to him with the words of the Easter greeting. My joy, Christ has risen. It's been about 200 years since the days of Saint Seraphim of Sarov. Things have changed a lot since then. The Russian church has been through its near demise and revival. In 1988, the year of the 1000th anniversary of the Christianization of Rus, the Soviet regime ceased to press the Russian church. The so-called Iron Curtain gradually fell, and religion openly and naturally became part of a public life. Many post-Soviet people have become interested in their historical heritage and in the different spiritual practices. They wanted to find a kind of foothold in a changing world, and they found it in the face of Orthodox elders. At that time, 30 years ago, the elders and elderly nuns who were not broken by the Soviet system were still alive. They were people with a steadfast faith, ready to die for the Christian belief. Their wise words and prophetic counsels could radically change everyone's soul and mind. Their talks and advices could change even the confirmed atheists to the ardent believers. About 30 years ago, only in the Pskov-Pechersky monastery there were 8 outstanding elders, each of whom was like a bright star. Their colorful portraits are given in the book Everyday Saints, well-known book written by Bishop Tikhon Shevkunov. Some of them kept silent. The others spent 10, 12 hours per day speaking with pilgrims. Many of them were gifted with discernment and foresight. The oldest monks of the Sretensky monastery, where I live, quite well remember at least 4 of the last elders of the Pskovo-Pechersky monastery. As time went on, they passed away one by one. Almost all of the post-Soviet elders have already died by now. Elder Nikolai Guryanov from the Zalit Island died in 2002. Father Ioan Kristiankin died in 2006. The All-Russia confessor Archimandrite Kirill Pavlov of the St. Sergius Lavra about 17 years ago had a blood stroke and has been bedridden since then. See Archimandrite Eli Nozdrin is still alive, but it's not easy to talk with him. Dozens of pilgrims stayed day and night by his doors, wanted to talk with him. By the early 21st century, there was a paradoxical situation in Russia. In the first decade of free development of the church, there was created a stratum of parishioners who were looking for a high level of spirituality. But fathers died, and their younger ancestors are not so strong spiritually. That's why those who sought for spiritual heights began to turn towards Mount Athos, and they were not mistaken. 20 years ago, there were many outstanding personalities on Mount Athos, like Joseph of Vatopedi, the successor of Elder Joseph the Hesychast, Elder Ephraim of Philophei, nowadays he lives in Arizona, another disciple of Elder Joseph. He is known for founding 19 Orthodox monasteries in the USA and Canada. Elder Georgi Kapsanis from Grigoriou Monastery, close friend to the teachers of the Moscow Theological Academy. Elder Vasily Gondikakis from the Iveron Monastery, he likes Dostoevsky very much. The Elder Emilian Vafidis, who was an abbot of the Simonopetra Monastery, and our Sretensky Monastery have many common projects with this Simonopetra Monastery. So, these and other fathers made Athos an attractive place for thousands of pilgrims who were searching for spiritual life. Joseph the Hesychast probably was the first elder of Mount Athos, well known in Russia. He became known thanks to the books with his letters and conversations. The books comprised his letters were carefully collected by the monks of the Philophei monastery. However, according to Archimandrite Simeon Gagatik, he's a translator of Elder Iosif Isichast's books into Russian, the Greek collection of Joseph's letters entitled Expression of Monastic Experience contains some weak points. Firstly, this book doesn't contain all his letters. Secondly, some of the letters are abridged. Therefore, Father Simeon Gagatik undertook a search for the original sources all over Greece and the USA. In Arizona, he found some audio recordings with the conversations of Elder Ephraim, which the Greek publishers has deciphered and abridged and printed in their book. Father Simeon deciphered them himself, translated into Russian and published in full. Therefore, probably the Russian edition of text about Elder Joseph the Hesychast is fuller today than its Greek analogous. The total amount of Russian copies has already exceeded 100,000. Elder Joseph the Hesychast was a strict hermit. His brotherhood lived in different places. So from time to time he changed his place of living. But the most famous place of their residence, their shelter, was a place on the rocks of Agia Anna Skit. His brotherhood was small, 6 men only. Elder Joseph and his monks deprived themselves of sleep and food. Sometimes they ate rotten food. From time to time, dead mice and snakes fell into the barrel of water from which the monks drank. They drank that water. The monks thought that it was a miracle that they had survived after going up the rock many times on a narrow path with heavy loads on their backs. So their life was very severe. And in the center of that life was, of course, Jesus' prayer. They spent nights in this Jesus' prayer. And what is the what was the purpose of such severe life? Of course, Father Joseph is well known because of his talks of the divine light, about the inspiration. But to obtain this divine grace, you have to struggle against your personal enemies, against your passions. And that's why you have to purify your heart. And his teachings about this purity of heart is very close to that what we can find in the 4th century's writings, for example, in writings of Macarius the Great and Antonius the Great. So, but despite the severe life, Elder Joseph was very thoughtful and loving. The first thing that strikes while reading his letters is the loving words he used to address his spiritual children. My child, my dear blessed child, my divine and sacred womb, my beloved child, my fragrance, my celestial flower, my beloved sister in Christ, confident of my soul, my true spiritual child in the Lord. He was in a correspondence not only with monks, but with nuns and with lay people. Elder Joseph believed, and actually such addresses is very similar to what we found in the letters of the Niels of Sor, Niels Sorsky. Elder Joseph believed prayer to be the main task of a monk. When monk says the Jesus prayer incessantly, God bless him with the grace, with the divine love. God doesn't need man. He is glorious in himself. He created his world in order to share the treasure of his great love. Therefore, the only thing he wanted from man is love. That's why Elder Joseph put love for God above all. Love Christ, and you will enjoy him immediately. There is nothing above love. Ask for love only, and the Lord will give it to you. Elder Joseph preached love, and love was both in his words and deeds. First of all, he ardently prayed for all people he met. The situations in his letters were full of concern and compassion. I pray for you with all my soul. I embrace you heartily. I prayfully kiss you. Elder Joseph had few disciples, but they spread his spiritual experience worldwide. And probably the main topic of his teachings to his disciples, of course, was about obedience. So obedience probably is a key word of all his teachings. Obedience to the elder, means fulfilling God's will. One of living successors of his spiritual tradition is our contemporary, the Metropolitan Athanasios of Limassol, from the Cyprus. When His Eminence Athanasios comes to Russia, thousands of people come to listen to him. He is often invited to speak at monastic conferences. Sometimes he speaks just after the Patriarch Kirill. He speaks on the Christian way of life, on the place of Orthodoxy in modern world, his attitude towards the Pan-Orthodox Council, which took place on Crete in June 2016, was admitted by many Orthodox people with great trust. Metropolitan Athanasios became so popular because he speaks to people simply and persuasively. The rule of his monastic life has been shaped on Mount Athos. His next surrounding, nearest surrounding in Cyprus, priests and laity, usually address him as elder, geronda, but not your eminence. I heard this personally. He is called a spiritual grandson of Elder Joseph the Hesychast. It means that the Orthodox people perceive him as their spiritual father more than their church hierarch. Metropolitan Athanasios used to be an abbot of a Cyprus monastery, Machaira. This Cyprus monastery, Machaira, contributed to that Russian convent in Maloyaroslavets, it's close to Moscow, and has completely transformed its spiritual life according to the Athonite pattern. The matter is that the Machaira maintains a close contact with Mount Athos. But unlike Athos, Machaira is open for visits not only by men, but by women as well. And thus, the Russian nuns visited this Cyprus monastery for several times. They invited an abbot of Machaira into their convent, they were in a correspondence, and so on. They studied the practical issues of the Athonite ascetics. So how monks use Jesus' prayer in their everyday life? Currently, the covenant of in Maloyaroslavets has 110 nuns. 10 nuns have already become abbesses of other convents. And 3 of the 5 convent kids are soon to grow into independent monasteries. This Maloyaroslavets monastery is also known because of its books about the elder Porphyrios Kavsakalevit. Thanks to this convent, Greek elder Porphyrios became popular in Russia. Once I asked the Mother Superior, why did you choose elder Porphyrios Kavsakalevit as an example of monastic life for your sisters? She answered me as follows. The presence of a monk among the people was the main mission of Elder Porphyrios. The elder often said that it's not the place that saves a man, but rather his way of life. Love for Christ was the most important aspiration in Elder Porphyrios' life. Actually, some of the Elder Porphyrios' phrases became proverbial in Russia, such as, Christ is life, Christ is the kingdom of heaven, Christ is our Alpha and Omega, Christ is our everything. Elder Porphyrios Kavsakalevit became well known in Russia due to the publications about him. He wrote very little, just letters. His conversations pronounced at different times were written down by his spiritual children. After a while, shorthand reports and audio recordings were deciphered and published in the form of books. Not all the publications of the elder's sayings contain his original statements. Some of the internet publications are contradictory. Most of them are likely to be an exact retelling of the elder's words. That's why in Russia there is a discussion about this heritage of Father Porfirik of Sakhalvit, because of some contradictory sayings published in internet. Most of them are likely the most trustworthy texts are those published by nuns of Chrysopegi convent, Greece, and translated into Russian by the Maloyaroslavets convent. In the last 15 years, Russian readers have learned about Joseph the Hesychast, Porfirius Kavsakalevit, and plenty of other Mount Athos monks. You can find the books about Athonite elders and every little shop in a church. More and more books about the Athonite fathers are published every year. Elder Paisios of Mount Athos is no doubt number one on this list. Elder Paisios is not just one of the famous saints in our time. He is the most famous Athonite hermit, according to the Russian websites. His popularity rating on Google and Yandex search engines has already exceeded that of the classical Russian elders like Saint Ambrose of Optina, Ambrosio Optinsky, and Ian Christiankin. In the Sretensky Monastery's bookstore, actually the largest bookstore in the Christian literature of the Christian literature in Russia, we sell about 65,000 copies of book about the life and saying of Elder Paisios annually. The total amount of books about him sold during the last 15 years has probably exceeded 1 million copies. At the same time, I asked it about this from the publishing companies. At the same time, there are plenty of videos, publications in social networks, small books, and there are different titles. Not only words of Father Paisios, not only his sayings, but also collections of his sayings titled like About Pain, About Passion, About Death, Teachings for Kids, and even Father Paisios jokes. Why did Elder Paisios became so incredibly popular? He wasn't a university theologian, nor did he hold any administrative post in the church hierarchy. Like Joseph the Hesychast and Porfirik of Sakhalvit, he only had several years of primary schooling. He didn't seek to gather a flock of followers. He wrote just a couple of thin books about Saint Arsenius the Cappadocian, Saint Anthony Elder, Saint Athonite Elder Haji Georgi, and a series of stories about Athonite fathers. But it's not what brought him worldwide recognition. What was it then? His fascinating conversations recorded by the people coming to see him. He speaks about earthly, well-known things and uses simple words that are familiar to everyone. He tells various stories from his life, concluding them with most unexpected comparisons. Here is what he said about his younger years. When I was a novice, I read books. I tried to put what I was reading into practice. I didn't read for pleasure, to kill the time. I didn't read much, but everything I had read I applied to myself. Where am I? What am I doing? I put myself on a dock and didn't let what I was reading go in one ear and out the other. Elder Paisios liked jokes, but his humor wasn't a sneer at other people's shortcomings. Rather, his jokes were instructive parables with modern plots. Once he was asked, if there were a great variety of dishes on your dinner table, what way would you stop yourself from eating too much? His answer was, you see, it's like many political parties gathering in your stomach. They're quite small, and therefore they cannot form a majority in a government. One party irritates another. They clash and fight. And so begins indigestion. The conclusion of this parable is as follows. You'd better eat one type of food at one time, but not everything that pleases your tongue. We don't know whether Elder Paisios of Mount Athos was as physically strong as Saint Seraphim of Sarov, but we know exactly that he, like Siloam the Athonite, did military service. In 1945, a civil war began in Greece. Paisios was enlisted and served as radio operator, a signalman, for 3 years. During this period of time, when he accidentally knew that one of the soldiers was married and had children, he asked it to send him on mission instead of that soldier. He had to put his life at risk many times, but he would say, when you are ready to die, you have nothing to fear. Determination to die protects you better than 1,000 bodyguards. Those who forget themselves for the sake of others or for everyone's good are granted divine force. And you see, God protects those who are driven by self-sacrifice. The elders' war memorials, his words about military service and spiritual courage, were published in Russia, and now they are in great demand among young people, teenagers. In these books, the hero is the one who has the courage to stop evil from spreading, and not the one who knows how to kill. The theme of heroism in the World War II is very close to Russian people. This topic is not only a part of patriotic education of modern Russians, but a part of the personal history of many post-Soviet families, in which grandfathers and great-grandfathers died fighting against Nazism. Therefore, those old Russian monks who fought for their motherland are greatly respected by society. And let me give you a small example. Archimandrite Alipi Voronov, one of the most famous abbots of the 20th century, Father Superior of the Pskov-Pechersky Monastery, he went through the World War II and was awarded with a great number of battle honors. So, it's surprising, but actually not the memorials of the war made the elder popular. Paradoxically, the most popular collection of Paisios' works is the one entitled Family Life. Family Life. He was not married. He dreamed to become a monk since his childhood. But his personal life experience, his interviews and conversations with thousands of people, made him an excellent family psychologist, though he never had a family of his own. His reflections on family, children's education, a mother's role in the family, problems of childhood, diseases and death became his most popular publication. The book Family Life is first of all addressed for teenagers and young married couples. Famous for his strict selfless life, the elder protects the freedom of young people from their parents' pressure. He teaches that parents should rather help young men and women to follow their vocation than to press to fulfill parents' will. Sometimes, when talking with the young who are hesitating which way to choose, the elder remembered, "I see their inclinations, but I don't tell them, so as not to influence their own choice. What I try to do is to help them find the right way and peace in their souls. I try to exclude all the harmful from what pleases them and to leave their kind and the sacred only. I try to help them be happy in their moral life and rejoice even more in their eternal life." Very often the elder advised that young people should study and get some professional skills. Once a teenage girl turned to the elder for advice. "I am thinking of becoming a nun, but I am not sure. I don't want to study any longer at school." "You don't want to study?" Paisio smiled. "Okay, then I will tell your father to buy a couple of goats, a shepherd's dog, and a whistle fluid for you. The dog will be protecting the goats, and you will be playing the fluid and shepherding them. Do you want this kind of life?" Often people sought his counsel on the problem of family conflicts and divorce. The percentage of divorced is already nearing the number of marriages worldwide. "In earlier times," the elder one said, "life was less stressful and people had more patience. And today everyone like a cigarette lighter, instantly burst into anger and can't bear a single word said against them. And divorce automatically follows. The lack of patience is one of the most solid reasons for divorce nowadays. The biggest scandals begin small, no matter who is involved in them, family members or states. In order to learn how to tolerate each other's whims, the family should think of Christ, who sacrificed himself for our sins. Being innocent, he tolerates billions of people. But we, suffering from other people's whims, don't see our passions. We are unwilling to pay for our own sins by showing a little patience." The elder showed ingenuity in word and deed when restoring peace in families. Thus, once he sent to the newlyweds a card, which said, Christ and Blessed Virgin Mary be with you, Dimitri. I give you my blessing to swear at the whole world, except your wife. And I give to your wife the same blessing to swear at everyone, but not at you, Dimitri. It's better to be inventive in finding a reason for reconciliation than think out sophisticated ways to prick each other. Sometimes it happens that different troubles at work and at home make one grumble, and grumbling generates pessimism. A pessimistic person rejoices at nothing, grumbling all the time and seeing the world in black. To get rid of the habit of grumbling, it's necessary that you feel a little bit grateful. Gratitude gives rise to optimism in your soul, gives hope, banishes the devil. Grumbling is a way of destroying yourself. And if we accept everything happening to us with gratitude to God and sympathize with others, then we have God's blessing. God, the Elder One said, creates a miracle when we ardently participate in one's pain. The Elder didn't speak about abstract things. His conversations were the answers to the pain different people come to him with. He considered that any business and any profession can be made sacred by changing one's attitude towards them. Everything depends on the internal state of the person and on the thoughts that prevail, kind or evil thoughts. If the person tries to preserve kind thoughts in himself, it means that the person always sees the world in bright colors. Bad thoughts lead to misery. But sometimes it happens that your problem cannot be resolved in a simple way. You are talking to people and they don't hear you. You are looking for a solution to a problem, but can't find one. You are summoning up all your strengths, but there isn't enough creative power in you all the same. In such cases, the Elder advised to pray to God and to let God solve the problems for you and instead you. But what to do if you don't know how to pray? And moreover, you don't feel the need to pray. The one who don't understand the sense of prayer, the Elder said, doesn't feel the need for it, considers it a duty, is like an unreasonable child turning away from his mother's breast. Tenderness. And therefore grows weak and unhealthy. We pray to God not only because we need His support, we need His help. We pray to God because in this way we, His children, communicate with our Heavenly Father. Do you feel that your belief is weak? Be stuck to God like a child grabbing his father's neck. Embrace him and lean on to him. Elder Paisio's teachings has nothing to do with the moralizing of an old grumbler. Paisio's lived according to the gospel, and his homilies were based on his spiritual experience. His meekness and love were an integral part of his life. He strengthened hundreds of thousands of people through the world with his talks. And one more quotation. Seeing an elderly person, I say to myself that it's my father. Seeing an old woman, I say that it's my mother. Meeting a child, I look at him as at my little nephew. I love all. For some I rejoice, for others I feel pain. Are you familiarly to such a state? So probably main idea of his teachings is to be open to everybody, to be painful, and to struggle to love everybody. The elder Paisios said very much on various subjects. Not all of his words reached us. Not all of the publications with his words on the internet are true. The books, which we can trust, have been published by nuns of the monastery in Surati, Greece. These nuns took shorthand of his conversations, tape recorded them, kept his letters. After his death, these records were digitized, grouped into thematic blocks, and published in a series of 6 volumes, which is known as the Words of Elder Paisios. His books portray him as a cheerful, open-hearted man, sincerely loved by adults and children. This 6-volume series is more than a systematic collection of Elder Paisios' teachings and sayings. It's a kind of verbal icon of him, which is impressed on the memory of his spiritual children. The same we can say about the Russian translation. It's not always literal. The translation of the words used modern everyday Russian language. Translators tried to avoid archaic Russian words and Slavicisms. Besides, Russian translation contains more words than the original text, because the translators added many small additions to make the text modern and easy to read, especially for young people. Thus, in such a way, Elder Paisios became like a new Seraphim of Sarov, classical Russian saint loved by children and by aged. Copyright of the Russian translation of the words of Elder Paisios hold the Holy Transfiguration kit located in the Moscow region. In this one more Russian monastery, applying the spiritual principles of Athos and publishing books about the Athonite elders, all monks of this monastery are young. They are university graduates. All of them are university graduates, and some of them are working on their postgraduate thesis. They have chosen Archimandrite Parthenios, abbot of Agio Pavlo Monastery on Mount Athos, as their spiritual guide for his modesty and meekness. This 83 years old elder is not an outstanding preacher, nor is he a theologian. He is a man of prayer. Probably that's why young Russian monks have chosen him as a spiritual father. Their primary goal of monastic vocation is not to make a PhD in theology, but to put spirituality into practice. Books on contemporary elders wrote their spiritual children. They personally saw the elders and talked with them. They selected the best materials to create a verbal icon of ideal elder of the 20th century. The books published by reputable, well-known Russian monasteries aren't casual. The initiators of the Russian translations are often monks and nuns who practice Athonite style of life. Now that not many Russian citizens can afford to visit the Holy Mount, even fewer people are ready to learn Greek, to talk to the elders without an interpreter. The books about them are a bridge between Athos and the Russian world. Russian translators use such a style of translation to bring the image of the Greek elders to a Russian sample. These books are to create an image of an ideal modern hermit, an image of an elder without excessive severity or banal sugarness, to show that life with God gives people a lot of joy and confidence. Homilies of the Athonite elders are a treasury of answers to plentiful people's questions, though some of them are very complicated. The answers is always simple. One should focus his life on Christ. Christ is our Redeemer in the ocean of everyday problems. Christ is our joy and support. Christ is our Alpha and Omega. Christ is our everything. These words reflect the teachings of Athonite elders speaks of. These words reach the very heart of the peoples of Russia, make them look at the world in a different way. So, conclusion. Why do they have such an impact on the 21st century's people? Because the Athonite elders were strict with himself to obtain divine grace and were boundless kind to share this divine love with the other people. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Father Iriney, for that wonderful presentation. And you've explained everything so well, and you've given us many examples. With Athos, we have a holy situation, a holy location with holy men. These holy men speak simple, with great simplicity, so everyone can understand them. And you also have the beauty of Athos itself. Athos is a holy place, whether there are monasteries there or not, monks or not. And this combination is rather unique, and it's been captured very well by the Russian religious mind, I think. I've heard that the number of pilgrims, males, of course, going to Athos, it's greater than the number of males and female pilgrims going to Jerusalem, even. Which is an extraordinary statistic, because, well, that wouldn't be the same in Greece, for example. Mm-hmm. So, does anyone have a comment or question, observation?
Are there any Russian elders on Mount Athos that influence the Russian people, or indeed are there any Russian elders in Russia who are very influential at the moment?
So, if we'll see to the 20th century, we can find several Russian elders. And probably I should to emphasize it one the most influential to the Father Paisios. Well-known Papa Tichon, Russian elder, was the spiritual father to Father Paisios. So it's a very interesting thing that Russian elder taught Greek monk to become a spiritual man. And nowadays, this Father Paisios, Greek father, teach us to become spiritual men. But there were many outstanding persons. But unfortunately, usually they do not write. And 30 years ago, there were not special machines for audio recording. And that's why even in Russia, we lost most of that oral heritage. And we know about very good Russian fathers only by the memorials of their spiritual children. So there were many, but probably they were hidden from the common eye.
Are there any living today?
You mean in Russia?
In Russia and on Mount Athos, actually Russians, elders who influenced Russia.
Yes, of course. So I tried to emphasize on the name of the Geranda to Ayu Pavlo Monastery. I can show you Father Parfenius.
But what about Russian elders?
Actually, it's a question. On Mount Athos, probably no. But in Russia, yes, there are some names. They are not so famous as the names of Father Ioann Christiankin or Kirill Pavlov. But there are some, like Father Avrami in Yekaterinburg and many others. And they try to hide from the people, not being a pop star. So on Mount Athos probably no. That's why most of the Russian monks try to reach Greek elders.
And he spent, some years before he came to Russia, just before the collapse of the Soviet Union, in the late ages, Father Ili returned to Russia from Mount Athos and became the confessor, the spiritual father to the newly reopened Optina Pusti, where he came. So that's probably.
But what is the most interesting is that some of such spiritual fathers, for example, formerly Geranda of St. Pantelimonas, Father Iremia, he received a blessing from Holy Father Kuksha in Odessa, who went to Mount Athos for several years also. So probably even within 20th century, there was a bridge, not so strong as today, because of the borders of the USSR. But there was a bridge, and actually Metropolitan Nikolai Yerushevich have been there, and he have met Papa Tikhon, and there have been, yesterday we remembered him, an abbot of Ioann Bogoslovsky Monastery near the Rezan, Father Avel. He have been to Mount Athos for several years. So there were some fathers.
Maybe just again to try. Just a personal story, probably not publishing, I'm not sure. But the founder of our monastery is Father Sima, who also was quite renowned in our region at least. He visited Mount Athos with some of the fathers from our monastery in the end of the 90s, just about before his death, 3 years probably, when he died in 2002. And he used to tell us that he was hoping when he, while his visit, he would meet an elder, an Athonite elder. And he told us that he did see this saint person. That was just a monk, he wasn't a priest. And he had a conversation, he would tell us that he saw in him a little saint person. I know that he died, and his name now just out of my mind. But just mm-hmm. and he was very ordinary, not that particularly not noticeable, but somehow he managed to visit him, and he wasn't that renowned, I think, in his considering monastery. But he somehow was spiritually recognized and believed him that he was a spiritual person, of course, and see somebody who was.
Do you think Brother Joseph will be sanctified soon?
Will be. Probably it's better to say how many monasteries now venerate him as a saint. Mm-hmm. On Cyprus, you can find a lot of icons in the churches. A lot of Russian monasteries venerate him as a saint, Father Joseph the Hissachast. Yes, please.
Have the books that you mentioned been translated into English?
You mean letters about Father Joseph the Hissachast? Yes, words. Just words. Mm-hmm. They're very popular. Actually, there was one amazing thing which I found on a presentation of the last Father Paisios book. Very thin book about his life, his biography. And I contributed in sharing this book, and I participated in the presentation. So one old monk came, and what he said, he met just once Father Paisios, and they were speaking about current problem with the suicides. So we don't know how to pray, how to deal with that families in which members committed the suicides. And what was the example of Father Paisios? Very amazing story. He said, once a woman came to him and have told, my husband committed a suicide. He jumped from the bridge into the river. So probably he is in hell. And Father Paisios answered, no, he had a couple seconds to repent. So it's very interesting. So such big hope Father Paisios had in people and in their repentance.
I don't know if you have heard, but he was quite a traveler, and he even got as far as Australia, where he remained for Great Lent 1 year. I go to Australia at Christmas time, but sometimes I go at Easter, and I found him there. I knew him before anyway, because I translated his book on Saint Arsenius from Greek into English. So I had dealings with him, and he was quite a character. But I said to him, well, it's very noisy down here. Don't you find it's rather disturbing after the quiet of the Holy Mountain? He said, no, I'm not bothered at all, because I'm here in this room. I have people who come and speak to me. I speak to them. And whatever goes on outside, whether I'm on the Holy Mountain or in the middle of a city, it's just the same. He wasn't at all bothered by that.
Well, and when he spent several years on Sinai, close to the Saint Ekaterina's monastery.
He did.
And what we know from that years of his desert life is that he was in a contact with the local Bedouins, and he liked kids very much, and he was very appreciated by the local imam because of this big love to the Bedouin's kids. He shared sweets to the kids, and he had to travel through the mountain, so probably it's 5 or 6 miles, I don't remember, but it was a long distance. And once he went to one small boy, knowing that this boy is ill, and he brought with him a lot of different sweets. So it was a feast, not only for this Bedouin family, but for the whole village. So he liked kids very much.
Yes, he liked the Bedouins very much. He had the story of, you know, when we Orthodox go up to the shrine of St. Catherine and ask for some miracle or something, it rarely happens. But when the Bedouins come, always they get the miracle. I'll tell you one other story too. He had a bent with politics, you see. That word for political party in Greek is koma, and the word for colour is chroma. And so when he brought out his Turkish delights, he'd have different colours going on. And instead of saying, choose any colour, he would say, choose any party. They're all here. Well, thank you very much. That was very enlightening.
Thank you very much.
Before we depart today, I just would like to really to show our appreciation to all of the speakers that have been here and given us much wisdom during this conference. We've learned a great deal about Athos-Russian interactions from a variety of perspectives, history, spirituality, literature, politics. Every contribution has been absolutely enthralling. Each one has been delivered with superb skill and composure. So I'd like us to congratulate and thank the speakers. And finally, a final expression of great gratitude must be made to Simon and Francis. Their very careful attention to dozens of details, of which we only know but a small fraction, would not have made this conference such a success. Unimaginable are the numbers of hours they've sacrificed on account of their profound dedication to the cause of this, our charity. So from the bottom of our hearts, we thank you, Simon and Francis, and God bless you.